this paper together here. If you did not get a paper, raise your hand. Missy's going to bring one to you. If you didn't get a paper, raise your hand. Missy's going to bring one to you. Okay, up in the balcony, babe. Thank you, dear. Okay, before we do that, I'm going to show you a video, and then we're going to discuss it just for a second. This is a humorous video. Most of what I'm sharing with you tonight has come from help and research from people in that have been to some marriage conferences lately that have just helped me a ton. So kudos to you. You know who you are. May the Lord bless you in your private life with lots of money. Amen. Here we go. Roll that beautiful bean footage with sound.
It's just, there's all this pressure, you know? And sometimes it feels like it's right up on me. And I can just feel it, like literally feel it in my head. And it's relentless. And I don't know if it's going to stop. I mean, that's the thing that scares me the most, is that I don't know if it's ever going to stop.
Yeah. Well, you do have a nail in your head.
It is not about the nail.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, I'll bet if we got that out of there...
Stop trying to fix it.
No, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm just pointing out that maybe the nail is causing...
You always do this. You always try to fix things when what I really need is for you to just listen. No,
see, I don't think that is what you need. I think what you need is to get the nail
out. See, you're not even listening now.
Okay, fine. I will listen. Fine.
It's just, sometimes it's like, there's this achy, I don't know what it is. And I'm not sleeping very well at all. And all my sweaters are snagged. I mean, all of them.
Yeah, that sounds really hard.
It is. Thank you. Ow!
Oh, come on. Ow. If you would just...
Don't...
Try to see things my way. Do I have to keep on talking till I can go on? We can work it out. We can work it out.
Okay, you can turn it off. Okay. Do not raise your hand, but have you ever been a part of this conversation before? What? Okay. Now... Here we have this girl, okay, and we're not going to roll with any kind of gender stereotypes tonight. Everybody say amen? I don't think we're going to. Anyway, but there's this girl, and she has this nail in her head, and she's like, and she's talking to her husband, and he's pointing out what is the obvious. If we get that out of your head, things will get better, right? Let's pretend the nail... is a thought. Are y'all with me? Let's pretend the nail is a thought. If you get that thought out of your head, then this is going to be, I don't need you to fix me, I need you to listen to me, right? And so here we go. In this, you turn this mic down just a little bit, it's like real loud, okay? So in this conversation is what I think this conversation goes is the way they've been taught to handle conflict. What I mean by that is your next fight with your spouse, the parameters and how that fight's going to go, I use the word fight. Please understand, I'm not talking about a fist fight. I'm not talking about physical violence. I'm talking about a disagreement, okay? What I'm saying is your next argument with your spouse, you're already establishing the framework for that next one, how it's going to go. Does that make sense? You're creating expectations from previous things of how that's going to go. How do we know this? Look at the video. You always try to fix it. So your current fight that you're going to have is not just about that moment in time. Does that make sense? It's about the previous things that have done good or bad in the future that have created the environment for how that fight's going to be played out. Okay, I think for me, okay, she's like, you always try to fix it. Now, she may have a legitimate reason for saying that. Make sense? And this point, I think it's pretty obvious the nail needs to come out of her head. But will she listen to him? Why? Because of possibly the way he's handled it in the past. That makes sense? Okay. Secondly, whenever she goes off and she's like, "You always try to fix it, blah, 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 blah." He goes, "Whoa, I've seen this before. I don't want to have this conversation." So what does he do? He just backs off and he's like, "Yeah, okay. That sounds hard, right? That sounds difficult." And so he's appeasing her irrationality from a fear that obviously isn't happening right there. It was something that happened before that makes him back off so quickly. See, part of you is thinking like, "Well, why didn't you just go ahead and just reach up there and grab it out of her head?" You know? Why are you appeasing this? This is ridiculous, right? But my point is on both sides, whatever happened in the past set up the parameters for how they were going to respond in the present when they have a fight. Do you understand what I'm telling you? So, your next argument, your next fight, your next disagreement with your spouse is being arranged right now. By the last one. By the mood of the household right now. If we're going on 4 or 5 good, healthy months of nice, loving interaction, then when this thing blows up and we have to have a disagreement, argument, fight, whatever you want to call it, it's probably not going to be as bad if we're on 4 or 5 months of being at each other's throat. You understand what I'm saying? So my point is so many times when couples, they having a breakdown, and they'll come into my office and they'll sit down and they'll begin to describe this current immediate issue that they're having. They're looking at what's happened in the last 24 hours, what's happened in the last 48 hours. They're not looking about all the behaviors that have led up to this moment. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? Okay? So that works both ways. I think that she is legitimate, as ridiculous as the video is with the nail sticking out of her head, she's legitimately saying, based upon your previous experience, I'm not going to let you do that to me again. Right? And then the first time I saw this video, I said to the person who showed it to me, he's a scared puppy. Right? I mean, he's like, okay. And he's like, "Dude, man up and just take the nail out of it," right? What did you do? He cowers because he's been taught that if I keep poking this bear, it's gonna bite. You see what I'm saying? Okay? So in that kind of thing, you're going to have disagreement, you're going to have argument, you're going to have dysfunction. I wish they was all as easy as just pulling a physical nail out of your head. But if we take that nail and transform it into a thought, if we take that nail and transform it into a wound, how do we fix that? Is it as easy? You see what I'm saying? You understand what I'm telling you? And so my point being is that when we come to an argument, both parties in this video, her and him, they are responding to the other person based upon the fear of past action. That makes sense? So, I wish I could. There's this thing called the fear cycle, and I wish I could teach you. I can't. I'm not good enough. But in this fear cycle, it's we respond to people out of fear. That makes sense? And then that fear, if we don't break the cycle of so if I have buttons, in other words, if she does something that sets off one of my buttons, okay, this will make perfect sense to married people. She does something, sets off one of my buttons, I respond to the button, and guess what it does? It sets off one of her. And then when she responds, and then here we are, and we're caught up in a cycle. That makes sense? And so my point is how do we stop the cycle of the fear-based responses to what each other's doing? You always try to fix it. How do we break these cycles? What most couples want to do is tell you, the other person, to stop doing what you're doing and I'll be fine. No, you won't. Right? Are y'all okay out there tonight? Well, if Missy wouldn't do this, if she wouldn't push my buttons, you understand what I'm saying? If Missy wouldn't push my buttons, I'd be fine. So Missy needs to not push my buttons. Missy needs to be adult enough to understand what all my buttons are, the multifaceted layers of buttons in my life, and not push any of them. And if she's irresponsible to not push my button, then she deserves what comes out when you push the button. This is how most people approach the problems of their relationship. You don't push my buttons and we'll be fine. That makes sense? There's some truth to that. There are things that I absolutely know that if I say to her, it will not be a pleasant response. How many know what I'm talking about? I know there are some buttons, and then some days my care is not as high as it should. I just don't care. So today, I'm going to push up, because that's what selfish little whiny people do sometimes. They push buttons even when they know it's going to be a bad thing. That makes sense? Don't act like you ain't never done that. Okay? But the deal is there's some truth to that. If I know something's going to bother her and we get into a heated fight, if it comes out of my mouth, I willingly made the decision to let it come out of my mouth and said it, and I pushed a button. We've all been there. We've all done it. The only thing that you can do to stop that is you get more sanctified and stop being immature. Amen. Speaking to me too. Okay? But the other side of the equation is, if I care for myself, and that's where the top of this page is called, the care cycle. If I care for myself, then there's less fear. Because I believe most of our conflict comes and revolves around fear. That makes sense? Now, I'm not a big fan of the teddy bear, okay? But it's there. So it just is what it is, because it's a care bear. Y'all get it? The care bear. Okay, now, so we're going to talk about the 5 A's of caring for yourself. Here's the deal. If you would stop trying to fix the other person and fix you, it's probably going to work out a lot better for you. Amen? Okay, so here we go. Number one, the fear cycle can only be broken by taking space. Write it down, space. Space. If you don't have a pen, bite the end of your finger, let it bleed a little bit, and then just write it in there. That's a joke. Don't do that. Space. Now, here's the thing. I don't like this. I'm the kind of guy, and raise your hand, male or female, if you're in the room and you're like me. Once there is a argument going, I want to hash it out until it's over. I don't want to stop until we're done. Raise your hand if you're like me like that. Okay. Now, raise your hand if you're like Missy. Missy wants to stop and let there be some space and then let there be some time and formulate her thoughts. Right. Okay. Okay, good. Okay. All right. Now, in the past, I would misuse scripture and said, don't let the sun go down in your anger. That's an abuse of scripture, by the way, if you ever use that on your spouse. All right. I've been told that. So that's what I'm going to stick with so I can be safe. Okay. But my point is that there's truth in the idea of space. Now, just because you take space and take moment, and you get into an argument, you get into this fear cycle, you're getting worked up. Every time you see each other, there's contention. It's like a ticking time bomb around your house. You know what I'm saying? And you're walking on eggshells. And you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm talking about, right? Married people, right? You're not necessarily fighting, but you know that any minute the wrong move, and it's going to be like, right? I mean, what I'm talking about. Good. Okay, so take some space. Now, what you do in that space matters. Just because we take space, but if all I do with that space is go sit there and meditate on how bad it is and meditate on how bad they are and meditate on bad how wrong they are, then that's not going to fix it. But if in that space I care for myself, then we can get somewhere. Are y'all with me? Okay? So here's how we do that. A, be aware. I think this is so cool. Bill Johnson talks about this thing about, he talks about like hearing from the Holy Spirit, and he talks about how your physical body will respond to the Holy Spirit. How many of y'all know what I'm talking about? So how many of y'all have ever your ears will start tingling or something like that, whatever. Okay, but the same thing is true. When you start getting worked up, your body responds. It's so funny. No. Anyway, so... Yeah, you're talking, and me and Missy will be getting into this cycle, and things are heating up, and all of a sudden she's angry. And I'll say, you're mad, aren't you? And here's Mrs. Dill. I have plenty of faults, but here's one of hers. When we're arguing, she will never, ever agree with anything I say, even if it's true. Is that true? Okay, it's true. So if I say to you, you're getting mad, aren't you? She's like, I'm not mad. Her jaw is set. There's a vein in her head because her body is responding. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Your blood pressure starts going up. Your heart rate's accelerated. The veins are popping out of your neck. You're mad, aren't you? I'm not mad. Right? And it's just like, okay. All right, so if you feel yourself getting that way, take some space. Don't be like Chester. Don't be like when you feel yourself getting that ready, that's when you're ready. Let's talk right now, right? Don't be like me. That's bad, right? If you feel yourself getting worked up, you feel the heat, you feel your palms start sweating, right? How many of you cry when you get angry? And you're like, man, you know, they're sad right now. I've hurt their feelings. Oh, no, 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 no. They're going to kill you right now. You understand what I'm saying? And so, you know, your body starts to respond. All right, you have to learn the signals, and you need to respond to what your body's telling you and take a chill pill. Take some space, okay? So be aware. Be aware. When they train airplane pilots, they'll put them in a chamber, and they'll put them in a simulated airplane chamber, and they'll be flying along, and all of a sudden they'll cut the oxygen, and all these pilots will pass out, right? And they'll keep doing that over and over and over on these airplane pilots. They'll cut the oxygen. They'll cut the pressure in the cabin so that they will begin to recognize the bodily symptoms of not have to be totally reliant upon their instruments. I notice that every time I'm about to pass out and something's going wrong, that, you know, I notice that you know, my palms get sweatier. You see what I'm saying? And so learn the symptoms of what's setting you off and listen to your body and don't ignore it. Right? It's okay to say, Chester, the vein in my head is popping out. You should be quiet right now. Which doesn't help when she says you should be quiet right now. Because my vein is popping out of my head. wait, go. Number two, accept the feeling and the responsibility. Accept the feeling and the responsibility. When you're in an argument and you've taken some space, my heart rate got high and I decided to take some space, and you go sit down by yourself and you're listening to yourself, ask yourself this question: what am I feeling? And then look at me. Don't lie to yourself. Again, we go back to this concept. Missy, are you mad? I'm not mad. Okay. Talk to yourself about that, and we'll talk later, okay? Most of us, when we're beginning to feel some things, we'll get into denial. I don't really feel that way, you know? And we'll start denying this thing because we don't want to admit some of the stuff that we are emotionally feeling right now. That makes sense? So don't deny some feelings, even if they scare you. At the same time, you have to take responsibility for your own feelings. Does that make sense? I can't control Missy's emotions. I can't control your emotions. I can apologize all day long to Missy to try to appease her emotion, but at the end of the day, it's her control of her emotions. Does that make sense? The only person in this world's emotions I can control and take responsibility for is mine. Galatians 6:5. If you'll throw it out there real quick. Galatians 6:5 says this. It says in my Bible, Galatians 6:5, every believer is ultimately responsible for his or her own conscience. What's inside your head, what's inside your heart. Our conscience is more than just what we think. It's the embodiment of our head and our heart. Every believer is ultimately responsible for his or her own conscience. So what you're feeling, don't deny it, but you have to take responsibility for it. Does that make sense? You've got to take responsibility for it. Okay? Now, here we go. I love this little phrase at the end of that, except it's your heart, it's your job. My heart is my job. That makes sense? My heart, my job. Missy is, I am somewhat responsible for her heart. Yes, we are one. But at the end of the day, it's my heart, my job. As a good husband, well, I try to protect and value her heart, correct? But when I'm not doing my job well, she has to self-care. She has to take care of her heart. Proverbs chapter 4, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. So if life in the marriage is dependent upon two healthy hearts, we have to guard that. I can't always guard her heart, but I can guard mine. Does that make sense? So caring for self, I have to guard my heart. This is why I think, this is why I think teenagers shouldn't date, because I don't think they have any ability to responsibly guard their own hearts. Young teenagers, okay? Ability. Okay? And so my point is that you have to guard your heart. All right, here we go. Verse number next, allow. Number next. Number A, allow. So you have become aware of what's going on in your body. You have accepted what's going on in yourself. I'm not in denial. I really am more mad than I think I am. I really am more hurt by that than I think I am. It has saddened me. You sometimes have to take responsibility for all those actions, okay? And number three, allow God to join you. This doesn't sound like a big deal, Christian. It's huge. One of the last things I want to do when I'm mad at Missy and I'm acting like a fool is say, God, would you come and join me right now? Am I alone? The last thing I want to do whenever I showed my rear end and said things I shouldn't have said and feeling things that I'm leaving unchecked and all that kind of stuff, the last thing I want to do is say, would you come help me right now? I'm talking about me. I ain't talking about you. I'm talking about me. The last thing I want to do is say, God, I need you to come and help me right now. Okay? I said this many times in the past when it comes to marriage. If Missy and I have gotten into an argument or things aren't, let's not even say we're in an argument. Let's just think that I don't think it's as, our relationship is doing as good as it should be at the moment. Does that make sense? If I go to prayer and I begin to pray, anytime we've ever been in a fight, and I go and pray for an extended period of time. I'm not talking about 5 minutes. I'm talking about I go get in a place of prayer. I always come out of that place of prayer more tenderhearted to the situation. And 100% of the time, God has dealt with my heart. Does that make sense? Okay? Because if I will actually allow God into this situation, he will get in the situation. And he will start talking to me about what the real issues are. Not my perceived issues. Or even if the perceived issues are legitimate, how I should actually be responding to them. That makes sense? And so it is imperative. Christian, listen to me. It is imperative you allow God to join you in your, to break the fear cycle of when you're in contention in your marriage. It is astounding how many Christians, God fearing, Bible-believing Christians will put God in the back closet for a while they try to deal with their marriage. Amen? I mean, it should be fundamental. Think about this. I have had couples come to me, and they sit down, and they'll say, we want to get a divorce. We're done. One of them does. And I'll say, have you prayed about that? Almost 100% of the time. No. Almost 90% of the time, they'll say no, and the other 10% of the time, they'll lie. You see what I'm saying? Well, yeah, God told me because she makes me mad, I can divorce her, which is not in the Bible, okay? So my point is you've got to allow God into it. If I pray for my wife, then you'll get better. Hebrews 13, 1 through 6. I'll read it. Now, if you got it, can you put it up there real fast? Hebrews 13, 1 through 6. Hebrews 13. This is a mean piece of scripture here. Hebrews 13, I say mean, it's what we need to hear. It's hard. Hebrews 13, no matter what, make room in your heart to love every believer. So let's go with our spouse there, okay? Show hospitality to strangers, for they may be angels from God showing up as your guests, okay? Keep on going. Identify with those who are in prison as though they were suffering as though you were suffering with them, those who are mistreated as you could feel their pain. Verse 4, honor the sanctity of marriage. Y'all with me? Honor the sanctity of marriage. Keep your vows of purity to one another, for God will judge the sexually immoral in any form, whether single or married. Okay. Verse 5, don't be obsessed with money, but live content with what you have, for you always have God's presence, for hasn't he promised you, I'll never leave you alone, never, and I'll never loosen my grip on your life. Somebody say amen. Okay, verse 6, so we can say with great confidence, I know the Lord is for me. I will never be afraid of what people may do to me. Listen to me, pray that prayer over the sanctity of your marriage. What do we say? They're doing this to me, and they're doing this to me, and they're hurting me this way, and they're doing this to me. I know that the Lord is for me, and I'll never be afraid of what even my spouse might, I will not be afraid. Your confidence to break the fear cycle has to be the involvement of what heaven will do in your marriage. It is a spiritual union. Amen? Verse 7. Don't forget the example of your spiritual leaders who have spoken God's message to you. Oh, we're supposed to stop there. My bad. All right, let's go. Next. So allow God. At this point, if you become aware of what's going on, okay, if you are accepting what's going on, you're not in denial about the situation, you're taking responsibility for it, you're tending to your heart, and you've asked God to join in, you're probably doing pretty good. How many of y'all fight this way? Yeah, that's what I thought. Me either, most of the time. Missy does every time because she's beautiful. Attend. I love this sentence because I get to say it and not feel bad about me saying it, but just, you know, let the sentence speak for itself. I love this sentence. In this step, the grown-up me. Everybody say, the mature me. Is there a mature you? How many of y'all looked at your spouse and, There is a mature me. Isn't there? Anyway, here we go. In this step, the grown-up me assists, consoles, and guides the child part of me. Everybody say the immature me. Yeah, once you allow God in and get in that place of prayer, then you appeal to that mature side of you and say, God, I need you to help the immaturity in me. Yeah? Okay, good. How many of y'all ever acted like a kid in your marriage? Help the child part of me that is panicked by the fear, the button, the panic, okay? You're responding to fear whenever you are getting in a fight. Go back to our video. You always try to fix me. I don't want to be fixed. You're responding to fear. That makes sense? You won't let me be me. You're trying to control me. You're trying to manipulate me. These types of language is used in all kinds of marriages, isn't it? It's response to fear. So, how do we attend? What am I feeling? Again, we're going back to this thing. Can you be honest with yourself about what you're feeling? Can you really be honest about what you're feeling? Can you really be honest about what's going on in your head and in your heart? And because we as Christians, we don't want to accept that we're as rotten in our mind as we are sometimes. You see what I'm saying? You really got to get real with yourself. Be honest with yourself and say, you know what? I'm being much more of a bullheaded than I need to be right now. I have taken this molehill and I've turned it into, I don't really think that I was fully aware of how bad those things hurt me in the past. It's worse than I thought it was. You see what I'm saying? So you've got to be honest. What am I feeling? Is this familiar? Familiar. How do we know if it's familiar? The button that got pushed that set you off may not have been intentional and or really even your spouse that pushed the button. Let me explain it. Here's a perfect example. Perfect example. Okay? I want to buy something. My wife said, "No, you can't." And I say to her, "You sound just like your or my, right?" And what we're doing is a button had been pushed, and we're what is this familiar? I remember this feeling when I was a little kid and I wanted to buy this, my favorite toy ever, and my mom said no. You see what I'm saying? The point I'm trying to create in your mind is she may be completely right. You know what? We're budgeting right now to try to save up for this vacation, and you really don't need that, whatever. And so, no, that's not a good idea. Let's not do that right now. But you sound just like my mom. Because the familiar feeling of something in the past. Now, that's a little bitty example, but let's talk about, no, we're not talking about that. Let's talk about deeper issues in your marriage life of real trauma from the past. You hearing me? Real trauma from the past, legitimate trauma from the past, and she may or may not have ability to know exactly what's going to push my button where my mind is that day if I've been in a bad day focusing on some things in the past. And you see what I'm saying? So part of me of dealing with myself is this familiar? Is this a reoccurring familiar feeling that keeps happening, keeps happening in our marriage or keeps happening with everybody around me, that I'm feeling this familiar feeling? So not only is she making me mad, but my boss is making me mad and my kids are making me mad and you see what I'm saying? But what happens generally is all the buttons that everybody in our life is pushing when it comes to marriage, we put all of that responsibility on our mate. Y'all understand what I'm saying to you? So we be careful with that. Am I turning up the volume in some way? In other words, if the volume meter is from 1 to 10, this is about a level 4 conversation. If I make it into an 8 because I'm over-exaggerating. Did anybody ever over-exaggerate your issue with your spouse? Don't put your hand up. You don't either. Anybody over-exaggerate? I absolutely over-exaggerate. I'm that guy that is like, this should be about a 3 or 4 on the volume level, and I've been amped up to an 8, amped up to 9. Right? This, and how do you know you're doing that? Because you start saying, you always say, you every time. And dude, we're talking about, do we want to eat at Wendy's or McDonald's? Why are you being this way? You always get to choose. I never get to choose. It's all about you. I've just taken a simple little disagreement about fast food and made it into a big deal. Don't act like you don't. Our first real marriage fight was over a mushroom. Am I right? I turn turned up the volume on that one. When I reached over there, God made her that sandwich and put snuck a mushroom because she was like, don't put no mushrooms in my sandwich with a little snotty attitude. And I put one in there and she ate it and said, I told you not to make a mushroom. And I walked over there and I grabbed that plate and I slammed it in the trash can and I said, see if I ever make you anything again. Am I right? Don't think you don't turn up the volume sometimes. More than you that want to admit it, act like me. Maybe not. I'm probably just that bad. Here's the next one. But if you ought to have heard the way she said it, I mean, you would understand. What's the truth? Boy, we don't like the truth. We really like the perception, but we don't like the truth. That makes sense? What's the truth? Many times, it hurts me to have to admit that maybe some of this is more my fault than I would like to admit. But here's one thing I can tell you. If you have submitted this process and you're allowing God inside of it, you've got a way easier access to the truth than you would if you would say, God, I don't need you to stay out of this one for a while. Because he is truth, right? And then your next question is, what do you want right now? You know why this is a funny question? It's because how many of y'all have ever been where you've gotten to a big argument with each other, you've gotten toward the end, this big blow up, and then you ask this question. What are we arguing about? How many of y'all have ever done that? Well, what do you want right now? Based upon, I'm being honest with my feelings, I've identified if it's familiar or valid, I've turned down the volume, I'm operating the truth. Most of the time, what you want there is different than what you want when you started this process. At the beginning, I wanted to be right. Now that I've allowed God to humble me and I've seen the true me in this situation and I've attended to my heart and all this kind of stuff, now my desires and my wants are probably a little different than whenever I was just upset. Does that make sense? I may still need to listen. I'm not saying that in this situation I'm the guy who was wrong and she's the guy who was right or she was the guy who was right and I was the guy wrong and I'm the guy who's right. What I'm saying is, even if she has legitimately done something wrong and hurt me, I'm telling you, if I put myself through this process, even my want's going to be a little different. I still may need her to adjust and say, hey, it's really not okay for that to happen, but I'm not coming at you with a desire for punishment now. I'm coming at you with a desire for healing in this thing now. At some point, I just wanted you to pay for what you did. That makes sense? So, what do I want? Then the third action is act. What action? Literal action. Let's go all the way back up to number one. Space. You want to know why? The number one reason why Chester and many of us in the room who are the let's get this argument over right now are that way is because in the past when we've allowed space, there was no follow-up action to conclude and bring resolution. Right? So if you're going to give this whole process space, then there needs to be a tangible action at the end of this caring for yourself cycle that brings resolution to what's going on. If you just give each other space and never resolve anything, all you do is just increase the load for the next blow-up. Instead of one stick it down a mile, now we're putting on two and three. And some of y'all, in your life, you allowed the load to get up to catastrophic booms, when if you'd have just dealt with the stick way back here, your life would be a little better. Okay, praise God. How do we know that happens? Is because one of us will be in an argument, And we'll be arguing about what we're arguing about, what you never argue about, what you're arguing about. And then here comes a long list of things that have left unresolved. And what we have is the ability to say this or not. Hey, we dealt with that, and that was over. It's unfair to bring that the past up whenever it's already been dealt with, if it's been dealt with. That makes sense? But if it's not been dealt with, then it's still a free-for-all because we never resolved anything. That makes sense? Okay, so act. What action can I take now to grow in integrity and experience what I want? So I've come to the conclusion that I want us to not be at odds anymore. I want the cycle of fear to be broken. I want us to be, this situation to be over and resolved. I've dealt with my heart on it. No longer do I just want to be right. No longer am I just mad and want to be right. No longer do I just want her to pay for the wrong she did and have to, and pay back. That makes sense? I want reconciliation. I want there to be healing. I want there to be peace. Not peace of ignoring it, but real lasting peace of we've resolved it. We brought it to completion, okay? So that's what I want. So what do I need to do first, okay? First, the word B is boundaries. I like to call it accountability. I did a whole session on accountability. If you need to go back and listen to it, you need to go back and listen to it. Boundaries. That sounds like this. We're having another meeting to resolve the one that happened a week ago or 3 days ago or however. We both cared for ourselves. Missy, babe, I love you, and I'm not trying to punish you, but you cannot say, I wish I could light you on fire. That's not okay. That's obviously a, never mind. Anyway, so... There's a fireman here, and I want to say, if you ever come to my house and there's a fire, it's not me. Okay, so anyway, that's a joke. So my point is you go back, and it's okay in the resolution not to just be in this situation of we just let everything slide, it's all fine now. That's not resolution. That's pushing it back to deal with it later. Real resolution is creating some accountability and some boundaries. Hey, I get that you were upset about this and this and that, but it's not okay that you said that. It's not okay that you did that. There's real truth. That makes sense? So create healthy, accountable boundaries. So in the future that she absolutely knows, this is where communication. For some people, they don't like to be referred to as their parent. That makes sense? Not for Missy, but for some people, they don't like to be referred to their parent. So if Missy comes and said, I need to create if somebody comes to me and said, I need to create a boundary of, you don't call me that. And I do it anyway. She's created the expectation because she's created the boundary. And I choose to go ahead and do it anyway when I'm really, really mad at her. What am I? Y'all got real talkative all of a sudden. I'm immature, right? Okay? So only way she knows, only way I know, is if she expresses and creates a real boundary. You don't get to say that to me. That is a conversation you absolutely need to have with your spouse. It's not okay for you to say that to me. You don't understand what that does to me. That makes sense? We have to be love each other enough in marriage that we can create some standards. Right? Okay. Number two, integrity. That's where if we've created a boundary, integrity says I will maintain the boundary. Y'all with me? Y'all with me? Integrity is not necessarily something we're expecting of them. It's what's expected of me to maintain the boundary. So if we both take on the personal responsibility to maintain our own integrity, not to break these boundaries, we're going to have a better marriage. Does that make sense? That makes perfect sense. That's good stuff. It's almost like I'm preaching somebody else's notes. And number three, man. Anybody want to guess what G is? Anybody want to guess? Raise your hand and tell me what G is. Anybody raise your hand? Come on. What? God? Close. Huh? Giving? It is. I need you to give me money every time I get into a fight. No, what is it? Huh? Gratitude? What? You cheated. You didn't? You're smart. Grace. What's the likelihood your spouse is never going to hurt your feelings again? What's the likelihood your spouse for the rest of their life, last point, is always going to maintain the highest integrity and never cross that boundary again? Y'all really have confidence in your spouse, don't you? This is where grace comes in. Gary, you said, what is it that the keys to marriage is love and, is that, am I saying it right? Love and forgiveness. Love and forgiveness. If I love her, we're going to be great, right? Never going to have any issues. Raise your hand if you're in love and you ever have issues. Because some of you are lying. Where we get into trouble is where I have no grace for her or forgiveness. You see what I'm saying? Now, somebody is perpetually and intentionally not acting in integrity and destroying all those boundaries and going, at some point, you got to draw a line and say, hey, you know, my point is in everyday marriage, we are going to have to forgive. We're going to have grace. Lord knows my wife has forgiven me multitudes of time. I forgave her that one time she needed it. You hear what I'm saying to you? My action. What's the action step of this cycle of fear? I have cared for myself, and at the end, I have clearly expressed the boundaries. I've clearly expressed that we're going to have integrity, but at the end of the day, it's can I forgive and can I have grace? Are y'all okay? Okay. Take that home. You filled out the paperwork. It's just like the gym. You go plotting the paperwork and you have a membership. Now you're healthy. I have had a gym membership for a long time, and I'm fat, all right? You know why? Because the paperwork wasn't enough. You have got to put in the time. You've got to do the work. If you just have the principles in your mind, but you never put them into action, you're just going to be in a cycle of fear. You always try to fix me, right? You hear me? So do the work. I personally, as an individual, this is hard for me. I'm telling you, I'm admitting to you, this is hard for me because I don't like having to take space. I don't like stopping. I want to get it over with. I don't like it when we're at odds, okay? I want to get it over with because I'm the guy, look at me. How many of y'all like this? You're the guy that you can have a fight, guy or gal, You can have a fight, you can have the blow up, and you can be over it, and like literally the next day you're fine. It's like you're just fine. How many of y'all are like that? You're just quick to get over it, right? Now, how many of y'all takes you a while to get over it? Okay, great, good. All right, here's the deal. I may be over it, but and she's not, right? And then what happens? I get mad because she pushed my button because she's not over it. I thought we talked about it, you know what I'm saying? And so it goes on again. Here we are. Let's get the cycle starts again. And here's the deal. Am I going to say it's your fault because you didn't get over it and you pushed my button, or am I going to continue in grace? Grace. Grace. Okay? So is everybody good? Stand up on your feet. Lord, I'm going to pray this prayer over us. I pray that the adult in us would overtake the kid in us. Anybody taking that one tonight? Amens. I pray that the maturity in us would overtake the immaturity in us. And I pray, God, that we would not operate in marriage without your counsel in all things. We allow you in. God, give us the ability to have grace and set boundaries and have integrity, and give us the ability to overcome when we have these conflicts in our relationships, to do it right, to do it your way, and let us live in peace because we have learned how to fight well. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Love you. Good night. Thanks for coming.